This is not a drill, it's a warning. Mess with our dreams, you'll be sorry. Cause this has been years in the making, and we decide who takes the crown. We're fighters breaking. This is not a drill, it's a warning. Mess with our dreams, you'll be sorry. Cause this has been years in the making, and we decide who takes the crown. We're fighters breaking out together. Higher off the ground, we rise up singing.
We're the ones that built this city, so we're the ones that break it down. Warriors will feel the spirit. One step and there's no way out.
We're gonna burn this place down. Burn it down to the ground. If you're ready, make a sound so the world can hear you. Coming up now, all the smoke we're feeling.
Don't you worry, we're the ones who wear the crown. We're fighters breaking out together. Higher off the ground, we rise up singing.
We're the ones that built this city, so we're the ones that break it down. Warriors will feel the spirit. One step and there's no way
down. We're gonna burn
this place down. Burn it down to the ground. If you're ready, make a sound so the world can hear you. Coming up now, all the smoke we're feeling. We're gonna burn this place down. Burn it down to the ground. If you're ready, make a sound so the world can hear you.
Get here, over against the wall. Throwing my neck near. We were
This is not a drill, it's a warning. Mess with our dreams, you'll be sorry. Cause this has been years in the making, and we decide who takes the crown. We're fighters breaking out to
to build this city, so we're the ones to break it down. Warriors of fearless spirit, one step and there's no way out.
We're gonna burn this place down, burn it down to the ground.
All right. Good evening, everyone. My name is Mr. Honk. I will be joined shortly by the one and only Barry Mello, as he's just restarting his computer quick because he was having some issues. But tonight we have an exciting do or die best of five series in the lower bracket between TPO Cheezer and Poro Party Planners. Whoever ends up losing goes home, and the winner would go on to face the loser between EHC Nyx and Insomnia tomorrow, which could potentially be a big thing, as it could, depending on who wins and who loses, could be some rematches from round one of the upper bracket. I'm definitely excited to see this. We're just waiting on a little bit more.
Can you hear me?
Yep, I can hear you now. Yeah. And I took us in at the start, but how are you doing today, Mello?
I am doing awesome. It has been a long day. It has been a fun day. I am very excited for these games. I am exceptionally excited. We have these amazing Poro Party peoples over here planning some amazing parties and some absolutely cheesy picks up top lane with the Aztec Priest. I am looking forward to this game. I cannot explain just how excited I am for this top lane matchup, and I'm going to love to watch this bot lane fight as well.
Yeah. And these teams are both running with a couple subs. They have TPO Crow, previously known as Medusa, I forgot to update the slide, in the jungle, and then Flex Seal Phil in the support role for TPO Cheezer. And then Poro Party Planners is running Redisol in the mid lane, and then Sadist as their AD carry for tonight. Definitely excited to see these two teams go at it, and I honestly want to see a best of five series that goes to five games. It's going to be a long time, but it's one of those things that would be just great to watch. I know that GDG and LNG went to three games last night at Worlds, but I want to see a five-game series.
It has been a minute, I feel like, since I've seen a very good best of five. Even in Worlds, I feel like it doesn't happen too often. It always seems like a one-sided thing. LCK, you saw, like, T1 just got 3-0'd. Play-ins was the best of five. The last play-in game with BDS was absolutely incredible. The first two losses and then a total turnaround, absolutely incredible. So I'm waiting to see if these two teams can really duke it out tonight. And I think across the board, they have to be the most evenly matched teams in this tournament. So I'm expecting a best of five to go to five. I'm expecting it. I might be a little bit angry if we don't hit five games. Just a little bit.
Just a little bit. All right. But we are just waiting for the teams to ready up. All there shortly. Just quickly looking over the teams right now. I'm also putting them in the production document channel if you want to look.
Got it. Ah, the team of the legendary Hugh Janus.
Yes.
I was sad to see him drop from the team, but I understand he has things.
Realize that I did not update the top end on that sheet.
Oh, I think we're getting draft going here.
Ah, yes, we are, and we see the Diana ban. We did see, I had to remember that she changed her name. Leg played it last series against Insomnia. Zaya's banned as well, and Orianna. Those are two big picks right now. Zaya, we've seen her at Worlds, and she's almost in every single game. And it's just like the safest and best pick currently for overall. And then Orianna, just a menace in that mid lane. It's kind of like whoever gets Orianna, if it's open, just kind of takes over the game, and you don't get to say much after she scales, because those, if she's getting those ults out, she's going to hit hard.
I'm definitely glad to see the Diana ban come through. This is something that Leg is very proficient on, and it's just that overall, it's a nasty pick that can really stop you from doing what you want to do, and if it gets ahead, it just snowballs. Like you said, the Zaya, it really is a pick or ban. In Worlds, in current patch, it doesn't really matter. It's definitely a pick or ban. I like the Vladimir pick here. Vlad is just somebody you don't want to play against if you don't have the right tools to play against him. I'm kind of interested that Jinx isn't banned. She is huge on patch right now. So I'm wondering if that's going to come out. I see the first pick possibility of a Hecarim. This is... I'm kind of a little bit surprised, but it seems like they're trying to get rid of the jungle. Hecarim is also a champion that Leg plays very well and proficiently, and it's one of her top threes. So we've now seen pick one, ban another. Can she come out with a nice pick here?
Yeah, because just looking at her stats when it comes to the jungle in ranked, she's got 104 games on that Diana that got banned, and then it drops to 37 on that Hecarim. And then the next champ that she plays is Jax at 8. So it's kind of, I have some focus that I like. These are the champions that I like. Hecarim is an interesting pick to me because it's one of those things that the jungle feels like it's meant more for utility than it is for...
Well, the carry.
For the carry. But we do see the Seraphine picked up by poorer party planners, could be a flex
and
pick.
And then Evelynn. Ooh, I'm liking this pick. We're seeing two really strong carry jungles, but I agree with you. I think jungle is starting to get reverted to the way it was season 5 and all the way back to the beginning, where it was more of that utility tank role that you gank a lot, you support your team, and you're the big beefy person that just makes things happen. I like the Taric pick here. This is actually a really strong pick into this Evelynn. They pop that R. Evelynn's R is useless. You can't kill anybody. It's over. And paired with a Nyla. This is a really great combo. This is going to be a very scary bot lane.
This is looking like a wombo combo team right now. They banned Orianna, but you know what else is Orianna? Nyla. Her ult works the exact same way. And when you put something on like a Taric, she's going to have that capability and freedom to dash in and not potentially have it go off. But that's the Taliyah to kind of counteract these dashes and engages from the TPO side with that minefield. It's likely going to be mid lane because of the Evelynn, but that's a lot of AP. So you're definitely going to need some type of AD and top and potential for their AD carry and potentially top lane.
Yeah, I'm not 100% liking Poro's party planners draft here just yet. It is a very AP heavy, as you said. And Evelyn, somebody who she wants to be the only AP threat on the team. If she's the only AP threat, most people are not building MR, and she just gets to pop everybody because nobody has MR and she's the one AP threat. You've now added Seraphine and Talia, so they're going to be building a lot of MR. This Taric, this Hecarim are probably going to have MR in the build. They're going to be surviving a little bit more, and I don't know if with these picks that we have top and ADC, obviously ADC is a lot more AD focused, but top, is it going to be a tank or is it going to be a top like AD carry? They could try to pull out a solo AD carry here. I don't really like it. I kind of feel like they could have picked in a better order. They also got forced. Ooh, okay. I am liking this Sivir here. This is a very safe pick with that Seraphine. So I think this could be a good safe lane. That Seraphine does have the ability to stop engages from the enemy team with her R. Same with Talia. But we're hovering this Kassadin. How do you feel about this as a Kassadin lock-in? I'm kind of okay with it. I'm kind of not.
The Kassadin's a very interesting pick. I don't know how well it does into that Talia. Talia tends to, it kind of seems like she is a power pick right now, and not a lot of people are picking her up. The Kassadin does offer that promise to scale, but it takes quite a bit for him to scale. But regarding that bot lane, this is heavily now favored in Poro Party's planners, just solely based off the range of Sivir and Seraphine into that Nyla Taric combo.
Absolutely, yeah, I agree. I'm not sure I like the blind Mordekaiser pick. It's not horrible, but we haven't banned Olaf. There's a bunch of other things that can realistically set, can walk into Mordekaiser, and you can outplay him. It's kind of a skill matchup there. So I don't like that being a lock-in. I think like a straight-up tank instead of another bruiser would have been a great lock-in. Maybe some kind of just something else. I'm not really liking that Mordekaiser. And I feel like this Gnar, if he plays properly, all he has to do is kite this Mordekaiser.
Yeah, and it's going to be one of those things of how effective can that Gnar be in that laning phase as he's mini Gnar, because that's where he's going to get those advantages of just the constant poke onto the Mordekaiser, and if the Mordekaiser can make any sort of plays off of that, because if he gets poked down too far and Mega Gnar comes out, it could potentially mean a kill over. The Mord will have his W to heal back up, but it won't be necessarily enough to kind of heal if the Gnar gets ahead.
Yeah, I'm a little bit worried about this. Going back to the point, I just don't like a blind Mordekaiser pick. It's not horrible if you want to stop something like a tank coming out, but there's so many bruisers, there's so many fighters, there's so many ways of really getting around Mordekaiser. There does come a point where you can outsplit push him pretty easily. You don't have to worry about like more just walking up to you and out fighting. There's a lot of true damage. There's Gwen. I mean, infinite opportunities to just fight Mordekaiser and win. And this Gnar is definitely going to make an example, I think, of why that Mord is not a blind pick if he plays this properly. It's just that kiting ability. And like you said, if he kites him low enough, he pops Mega Gnar and the game's over. Either you have to flash or run away or you die. And there really is no in between. There's going to be one option or the other. And if you don't choose fast enough to run away, you're dead. So I think that this Gnar can definitely get ahead. I feel that this bot lane can get ahead. I'm starting to like Poro Planner's draft a lot more. I still don't like the Evelynn, though. I think there could have been something maybe tankier to assist the Gnar in the front line, so it's not just Gnar. You do have the Kassadin, the Mord, the Taric, the Heck that all want to be in your face, even Nyla. This is a pure dive comp, and you've allowed them to pick these beefy dive characters into a 90% squishy team. So I'm a little bit worried about how that's going to go, but I do love a lot of all the lanes, in my opinion, are winning lanes. I see them at least winning or holding solid, and we know that Sivir's just going to get a poke, farm lead rather. When she hits level 5, she just starts farming infinitely better. There's a certain spike she hits with items that Nyla just can't keep up. So I think if Poro Party Planners can get ahead they can solidly lock this game in their favor. If TPO manages to stop or mess up the Sivir and Taliyah and Gnar game plan in jungle ganks or maybe support rooms or whatever it may be, then there's definitely a chance for them to absolutely turn this around and win. I do think they have a lot of great, let's jump on your face and win. But Poro party planners, if they play this right and they kite, that their entire plan here with their draft is really just to kite, and once they're low enough, Gnar and Evelynn kind of press R and eliminate the team. And if they walk into a Seraphine R, it's even worse. So I'm definitely thinking that this is Poro party planner favored right now.
Yeah, which is surprising because apparently Chet with those predictions is heavily favored. Looks like currently no one has voted for Poro party planner. My biggest concern with them is getting ahead and then staying ahead, because the teams, as the teams scale, Kasten's going to scale and be a menace. If he can get access to that backline or there's any type of flank that comes in from the Hecarim, the Kasten, to get in onto the team and they're not just running at you from one direction, it's going to get really hard to peel. And when you don't have any true frontline, because Gnar's not going to be a true frontline. He'll be frontline when he's Meganor, but if he gets trapped in that mini form, he's going to be just almost as squishy as the rest of them. So it's one of those things of they have to play it right and they have to play it perfectly to get ahead into this matchup, where they need to get ahead and they just need to keep the ball rolling onto these onto the carries of TPO, where maybe they set them so far behind that it takes, instead of to like the 30 minute mark where they're looking at like being potentially the late game carries, they're getting closer to the 40 or potentially even 50 minute mark before they're there, depending on how. So I would like to see this Evelynn be heavily active in regards to those ganks, getting kills and boosting her lanes up while pushing their lanes down. So I think that's going to be where we're going to have to watch, is this Hecarim versus Evelynn matchup and who's making a bigger impact on the map.
Yeah, absolutely. The one thing, though, I think in that term, I think it's easier for Evelynn to make an impact. One thing a lot of people in any elo are not good at is, hey, Evelynn exists in this game, control wards out the wazoo. And if Evelynn can take advantage, and I think you nailed it on the head earlier, it's a lot harder for them to execute their comp compared to the other comp of, hey, yee-hee, we get to run at your face, press R, and you all die. They really have to play this properly. So I think if they achieve that, they do win. I think if TPO manages to hold a solid go even, the only lane that they really lose is bot lane. And if Kasten can get that R, if Hecarim can get a flanking R to push them into Kasten, that's what I'm going to be looking for a lot this game. Because if they can achieve that, then the Kasten just presses R on repeat, gets reset, starts killing everybody. Nyla gets to jump in, that kind of thing. If Mordekaiser can actually pull, I'm kind of thinking that if he pulls Evelynn, it might end up in the best situation, because his team just gets to face the rest of them that can't just press R and delete them. And then you get to just kind of focus them down. There is still the Sivir spell shield. There's still the Seraphine R. But again, like, I do think that TPO's comp is significantly easier to pull off.
Yeah, definitely easier to pull off. But with that, we are going to take a quick break as we do load into game number one. So don't go anywhere, and we will be right back.
All I do is work, hustle, grind hard. I ain't never gonna stop, nah. All I do is work, hustle, grind hard, level up until I drop, yeah. Independent grind, got no A&R. They used to tell me I
So much weight on my shoulder, I'ma raise the bar. Cincinnati flow, watch me crack the code. Sick and savage mode, might just catch a cold. Count my money up, yup, on my Casio. Give me a bag of dough and I'ma bounce out of yo. Everybody know what comes around, goes around. Middle fingers up when I feel broken down. My ribs are touching, I can hear my stomach growl. Make no bones about it.
Welcome back, everybody, to the best of five between a PPP and TPO Cheezer. This is going to be a spicy first game. I am looking forward to these drafts. I want to see if PPP can pull off the draft that they've given themselves. And I want to see if Aztec can just run face forward into them, press R, and win.
I will say that Talia skin, the Crystallis Modus one that recently came out, I have never seen a skin get so loved in the community for one champ as much as that. That's like all that you see Talia's playing now, is that Crystallis Modus skin.
Have you seen the Leona one?
I love the Leona one. I got it instantly. I'm kind of beating myself up that I've used all my Mythic Essence for the Talia one, because I honestly feel like this skin line is a bit better than the Ashen Knight line, because they're changing the colors of the crystals for each one.
Yeah, the Crystallis Modus skin line is absolutely amazing so far.
Oh, we got a little bit of cheese here as the Nyla and Taric went into their bush.
They don't know. Oh my god. Oh, the early poke onto the Sivir. Oh, is this going to be first blood?
The exhaust, ghost, and flash were burned. Just in exchange for hiding in that bush a little bit. But, oh, Nyla had to use barrier.
There are 5 summoners just expended in the first 2 minutes of this game, bot lane. And I think Nyla's in a worse position. They're both healing supports in a way, but I think Seraphine's just better with the Echo. So this is going to be interesting. You also, okay. Both are level 2 now, so this is going to be interesting.
Neither support right now has that healing aspect, though. Because they both started... EQ.
Yes, pretty interesting.
So no one's got healing yet, so both these 80 carries kind of have to keep thought up on how much damage that they're taking, as we see Nyla getting hit quite a bit. Level 3, 4 TPO's bot lane has reached up, and the Taric's going to be able to start the healing process. That is a weird looking chroma. But we see some fighting up topside as the Gnar goes in and tries to exchange a bit with the Mordekaiser, who's had him pushed in, getting a little bit of a CS lead. We're seeing just the poke from Poro Party's bot lane to just keep up the pressure.
I think they're running into an issue, though. Sivir looks like she's starting to climb back into the farm game, but we've allowed Nyla to get ahead, and she gives extra XP. She's ahead by 3+5, so 8 farm, 8 CS right about now, and that with her passive, I think is really, oh my god. And Leg goes down to the Hecarim in bot side river. No response from either bot side. It looks like TPO didn't even think to check because they just figured Hecarim had it. And they weren't allowing the Poro Party planners to rotate there. So that is going to be crucial. We talked about that lead stopping the lead early from Poro Party planners. And that's something that's going to be huge on Hecarim. First blood, getting that lead, getting the advantage. That is absolutely huge for them.
Yeah, and they were able to get the double scuttle. It's not as big as what it once was regarding XP, but that was definitely something that they want to see, because it's not a level 6 Evelynn yet, so she's not going to be invisible walking through these rivers if she does.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, honestly, double scuttle, even just one in one side of the river or one side of the map, is infinitely valuable in terms of vision. If you can see that Hecarim coming from far out to build his speed like they always want to, that's so huge to see that distance vision, knowing that Hecarim's coming up, you need to back immediately. That's such an advantage. Or knowing that Evelynn's coming, you need to back immediately because she's about to stealth. That is a huge advantage for them.
And we're seeing that just the pressure from that level 1 kind of wearing down onto the Poro Party's bot lane. While they backed TPO's bot lane, was able to get a plate just based around the back.
Yeah, a plate and a solid DS lead. I think they should have backed after taking that plate and crashing. Reset tempo. Right now, they'd be getting back. Lane would be right about crashing tower. And I think that would just give them a... Okay, we're seeing the top lane fight here. Oh, and it auto-zooms back to bot lane. All right. that this top lane fight is incredible. So he got knocked under tower. It looks like Aztec is about to go down. He can't react to this Mega Gnar.
No, his W is not going to be up enough to get the secondary heal proc. That's going to be a kill, solo kill over to the Gnar.
Yeah, that is definitely what this Gnar needs. And like you were discussing earlier, that's what the Gnar kited. The Gnar popped Mega Gnar, threw him under tower, and just beat him as the big boy. And that's just going to be the power of this Gnar into that Mordekaiser. On the other hand, this bot lane is interesting. TPO's bot lane is still solid. They're going in lane. They're focusing. They're holding on. Okay, we might see the Seraphine get caught here. The fail flash. She's gonna get stunned by Taric, and it is over for Divi Fuse. Oh my god, that flash being messed up just sealed Seraphine's fate. I feel so horrible. Because I know how it feels when that happens, and it is the worst thing in the world.
Listen, I am the worst when it comes to flashes. I will try flashing anywhere if I know that there you could flash there. I flashed so many times over the wall near Tribush that I have it down so many times, so well that I can do it in my sleep now. But the first couple times that I tried doing it, I was flashing in place and it felt bad. But it was something. Oh, that's not a good move by this Hecarim. Oh, this is not. He's gonna have to.
Hecarim's careful to get out though.
Yeah, he was forced to blow his ult, though, as well as that ghost there.
Oh, the Meganard topside slams Mordekaiser into the wall, doing an absolute burst of damage. Doesn't seem that he can finish him, though. That whole thing, Hecarim bot side, I think a bad placement, bad attempts to go in on Talia. Maybe if Kassadin had been closer, but I still don't think it was a good idea.
I think it was more along the lines of horse goes burr. That went through the head.
Probably. Yeah, probably. You're not wrong. You're not wrong.
But we do
Herald
see
is up.
Evelyn coming in here. She is going to get spotted now. Did not get the charm started up. But the Mordekaiser did come out. But it's going to get launched back. The Q doesn't land from the Evelyn, so he does not get charmed there for additional damage.
Seraphine seems to be here for security. She's going into lane. Manages to root, but unfortunately he does get that flash off before she can root him. So that's a good buffer
that
of her.
That wasn't flash, that
knee.
Was just the
yeah, his ult.
Ooh, this might be big here as Kasten does get knocked back, is going to be forced to blow the ult. I didn't even think about that. He's going to have that R to just kind of get away if he gets knocked back in the laning phase. So I think it was more along the lines of having a safe pick into the Talia.
It could be. It could very well be. We see some bot lane action here. There's full vision. I'm kind of surprised that Hecarim is not walking in. They know that they have full vision. It would be an easy gank. They're definitely pushing. It might be a Sivir, but you can definitely collapse on the Seraphine. But I kind of find it interesting that Hecarim chooses to just move on and ignore it. I do think that Poro Party Planner's bot lane just got very lucky, especially considering Seraphine is not 6 yet. They are falling behind here. She's
good
still not coming out
from the Sivir though.
Oh, but Leg is getting in here. The Taric all comes out. The Nylar. Oh, huge. Absolutely huge on the side of TPO. They just turned that gank around amazingly.
Yeah. But we're seeing what that Sivir can also put out here in regards to kiting damage. Did have to blow a lot just to get out of there, but was able to do return a lot of damage on back onto that Nyla after that kill went over right away. Nyla's actually rushing the Collector as well versus the static shiv that the Sivir is going to come out with, which will help with wave clear quite a bit.
Yeah, this Sivir is definitely falling behind in the one area that Sivir is supposed to perform the best, and that is farm. 20 farm behind, an assist and a kill behind. It is going to be unfortunate. And Sivir's not really a late game carry. Oh,
Mordekaiser up in top lane. It's going to be a solo
kill.
Absolutely amazing. Mini farm. I don't know.
Wow.
I think he had just went into the exhaust. So he didn't have the capability of getting back into Mecha to kind of fight there and ended up just paying for it.
Yeah, he managed to get the R off and Mega slam Mord into the wall, get some damage, but he just couldn't finish it. The mini Gnar just could not finish it. We're seeing this little battle here back and forth between Aztec and Leg. I'm not sure he wants to dive this. It looks like he's going to back off. We do see a Talia roaming up here, though. This Talia ult comes out. This is going to be a kill onto this Mordekaiser. That is a very good look and a very good roam from this Talia. Oh, we're seeing this Hecarim bot lane, but he is spotted on vision.
I think they're just trying to set up, get that bot scuttle there for that Drake, just keep on stacking those Drakes, because he was able to get that first one after the Seraphine did get caught out on that failed flash earlier. They are clearing out that Vision as well and looking for potentially an invade, but a big pull and engage from the TPO bot lane onto the Seraphine does get the kill. The Seraphine was trying to throw out the ult, but it did not get fully cast. So she will have that. It does look like they're going to try for a dive here. The Evelynn is here, though, so they need to play this careful. The Hecarim's just chasing after. They notice the Evelynn, though, and turn around. But the Sivir's able to turn around and get one in return. But this is going to be big chunks onto this bot tower. As yeah, they're now this, down four plates.
This might go first tower. If they get that next wave in here, they can wave clear. Yeah, this is gonna be first tower. This is actually very unfortunate. You're allowing this Nyla. She's now 2 assists, 2 kills. She has a bounty on her. She's up almost 40 farm.
She's got up in levels.
Yeah, she's now got the collector, as you point out. This is a very bad situation for Poro party planners. The Evelynn is 0-3. Yeah, the Taliyah has a kill. Sure, the Gnar is doing, like, pretty well in the top lane. He's going about even. But you're seeing the Nyla, who is going to become a big factor if she manages to get on anyone and press R with Taric, getting ahead. And that edge is going to be huge mid to late game.
We did see, meanwhile, the lanes kind of swap around. Taliyah and Taric went into that mid lane. Looks like they're putting Mordekaiser bot side and keeping Cassidy in top side. So he does have that teleport up. But we see the Mord pull the Seraphine into his death realm and is trying to get the kill out before it runs out. She is going to be able to survive long enough to flash away. Good survivability from the Seraphine, but I think that's going to mean Drake number 2 for Cheezers here, as the Seraphine was forced to flash and is chunked out.
Yeah, it is. It's not necessarily good to be letting them stack here. There's definitely a team that wants to scale, that wants to stack these dragons, and you're allowing them to do that. PvP is just in a situation where, like here, right, for this instance, they're allowing and have no choice but to allow these invasions and entrances into their jungle. They're down a tower in bot lane. Honestly, they should be rotating to mid. You see that the other team already has rotated to mid. Like, you need to cover, you need to swap. Taliyah is not there to 2v1, and you need to put that ADC in the safer position. Taliyah's taking a lot, giving a lot. She's in a rough spot there by herself. Top lane just seems to be doing what Gnar just doing what he kind of feels like he's doing. And Mordekaiser, just bot lane. I think they're going to start this in just letting Mordekaiser split push here. I'm not 100% sure that anyone can 1v1 him just yet. I think if anyone can, it's probably the Taliyah, but I'm not sure that she can if he pops that R. We see the top side here. Gnar, Mega Gnar ulties Cassid into the wall, but Cass just, he can't do it under tower. He cannot finish that under tower. Cass clearing weave.
I do think that's enough of a chunk out where this, no, he's not going to reset just yet, so it's going to be a little bit longer before that
this
top tower.
Taliyah. Oh no, this Taliyah walked into a very, very bad spot. This is something that as a support, like I know firsthand, if you walk into an area where the enemy has warded, you're by yourself and you're not sure if there's wards and people all around you, you're almost guaranteed to die. I've been there as a support. There's some times where I still find myself making that stupid call to just walk in there, and you can't do it. Especially with no bot side pressure. Taliyah just got caught out and punished. Here's a TP from Gnar. Gnar does have tower. He's free to TP. I don't know if I would count that as a useful TP. They were already backing off. Oh no, and he didn't stay, and they turned. Oh my God, the Gnar just griefed his entire team.
I think that's a bit of miscommunication that they're having right now, as they kept going, the Gnar teleporting at the very end of Mega was a bit kind of, he's not going to be super helpful. He's not going to have that ultimate up to help out in that fight. But I think Poro Party Planners just needed to use that as a way to kind of back off safely.
I think the Taliyah overstepped, and then three of them ended up chasing after the Gnar TPs and backs off. It was definitely not a good situation to be in. And I think they just have to, you know, there's no drag up. There's certain things that there are criteria that there's no reason to be in that situation chasing. I do agree, it probably was miscommunication between Gnar and his teammates. But I feel like it was a bit troll. If you see your teammates still going, and you're on a team, you go with the team. You know what I mean? And if you're just going to back after using TP when they were already running away from your team, it seems like a waste of resources. He didn't need a TP. He let his team end up dying because he didn't really see, or whatever the communication issue was there. And it just kind of really destroyed them. And it's now an 11-3 game with a 5.5K gold lead. This is not going to continue going well for PPP if they're having these communication or... I want to say coordination issues. Oh my God, Gnar is getting caught out. His team is not able to back him up in time. This is so unfortunate. That is a guaranteed rift for TPO. Like we were talking about earlier, I think PPP's comp is just so difficult to pull off. The Sivir is behind. She's not where she wants to be. They had the great level one, but then she kind of just backed off and didn't do what Sivir wanted to do. And it's starting to get to the point for PvP where they either need to make these comebacks, get that gold off the board, or this game is going to be over.
Yeah, they definitely need to start collecting this bounty gold that they do have on those turrets, some of those objectives. Catching somebody out, it's going to be hard, though, because the sideliners, who do you catch out in the sideline? We're seeing right now that they're trying to go for the Kassadin, but he just continues to press R and goes away. Meanwhile, the Hecarim runs you down.
The
Hecarim
jumping on. Oh my God, the Taric stun with the Hecarim. Absolutely incredible.
Huge Hecarim ult.
PPP started chasing. They overchased a Kassadin. You can't chase somebody who can press R and just get away on repeat. It's kind of a little... I think that PPP is being way too aggressive this game, and they're overestimating what they have the damage and capability for. It is an 8k gold lead, or 7-8k gold lead. There's no way that they should be attempting to straight up fight the enemy team with such a wallet diff and the level difference that are going on right now. The Taric is level 12, Seraphine's level 8. This is, you know, one of these things is not the same. And one of these things is not the level that the team needs it to be. And it's not Seraphine's fault. I don't think it's a one-person thing. It's just what happened in the bot lane when Sivir was not able to do what she wanted and couldn't do it past that level one skirmish. But now this lead that we're seeing from TPO is absolutely demanding. Or absolutely just... It's out of control, I think. It's going to get out of control. And like you said earlier as well, I kind of agree. Kassadin has not been so much of a carry pick as he has been a, I'm going to apply pressure. I'm going to do it safely because I can blink out with my R whenever I want kind of pick. And I think he's actually very smart for that. This is something that I did not expect either, but it's very nice to see that different use of this Kassadin in that kind of safe pick that will scale into something that can delete, especially when his team is already ahead by a huge amount.
And I didn't even think about it when it came to the draft. Cheezer drafted the two safest side laners out there because you have a Mord that unless you send three people, this is going to happen. He's going to pull you in. If he lands the pull, he's going to pull you in and then he's going to look for the ult and he's going to try to 1v1 you before anybody else can arrive. The Caston is going to do what we just saw before, where he's going to press R. And that just kind of leaves the Nyla, Hecarim, and Taric to just continue to run as a three-man around the map. And then just show up where they need to be. But this is going to be one of those things that we're seeing the Gnar and Caston fighting under turret now. The Gnar is, Seraphine.
Oh, we're going back top. Okay. Seraphine is down again. She can't stay alive. She's getting behind. I feel really bad for her. She's just in a rough situation. The Nyla experience as well for this Taric is huge. Leg is about to be caught out here. Oh no. And down this Evelynn, yeah, that Evelynn is down. This is a very bad situation. They have Shelly. They're about to take Inhib and Inhib turret, and they're gonna walk on their Nexus. This could be a 24 minute game. If they both die right here, this is absurd.
Ooh, that's a big shutdown, though, onto the right person as well, as it is the Sivir that does get it. Taric also goes down here. So that's two kills over.
Absolutely big, yeah. Although, I think the thing is, as well, is we see that Sivir is a great early game counter, mid game wave clear, or rather early game carry. I think she's dropping off of the point where she's a real carry, and she's more wave clear, immense sustain damage, but not necessarily the hard carry.
Nyla trying to go in 1v3 here, but God. Is going to give over another shutdown onto that Sivir.
I wonder what TPO is doing here. They're being a little reckless.
Yeah, no, they're kind of laying, like, they're sitting there going, like, our wallets are so far ahead that it doesn't matter, and it's mattering when you are going 1v5 and your name's not Mordekaiser, who can ult somebody first and at least go 1-for-1.
Yeah, yes, especially with Mordekaiser, he gets the R 1v1 and then come out with their power, their strength, if he wins that, or just lower them. This wallet diff is still 7-8k. It is a absolutely demanding lead coming from TPO. And I think we're about to see... This Caston definitely has the ability to open this tower. And
he's level 16. Sure, his Seraphs is built. His Roa is online at 10. We see that he gets the turret, gets one, and he's getting chased down here. It's going to get shut down, but they blew a ton. That was Seraphine ult. That was Sivir ult. That was the Proto Belt from the Evelynn just to get that kill. The kills are going onto the Sivir, which are helpful here, but I don't know how much they can last longer. The Evelynn definitely looking like it wasn't the pick this game, which just kind of showing the differences in the jungle. Gnar ults back under turret, is gonna get the Mord underneath the turret, might be able to get another shutdown here.
Huge.
Is able to do so, but then there's just the rest of TPO on the Drake getting soul. So they're winning these little fights, but they're so far behind that the map state is just not in their favor anymore.
Yeah,
they are sitting there going, like, maybe we can get to level 18 and get some picks, with the picks balancing out the gold difference between these fights and potentially winning a fight to kind of get us back into the game. But it's going to be a hard-fought fight because we're seeing several item differences. There's essentially no difference now between the 80 carries, but mid lane, it's 3 items, so 2.5. Jungle is a massive amount. We see the Gnar now 1v1ing this Caston, though.
The Gnar does look like he might get collapsed on here, though. Oh, they're going to back off. I think that TPO has been significantly better at not overchasing, excluding the Nyla 1v4. We're not going to discuss that one in this conversation, but I think that outside of that, they have been a lot better at not overchasing and knowing when to stop and get what they've got. And PvP has been very overdoing it, not playing the comp the way it's wanted. And honestly, I think this game is about to end right here. The Seraphine ult is down, but it only hits Hecarim. Sure, Hecarim goes down, but this is now a 4v3. And Sivir's
that was huge damage from the Kasten.
Absolutely huge.
Holy. But we're seeing the Gnar now get chance. So that's going to be a double kill for the Nyla in the end.
As absolutely huge.
The Mord teleports in and just starts tanking the turrets for the team. And that's going to be game one over to TPO Cheezers.
Yeah, this is absolutely huge. There's a 9k gold lead at the end of this game. 26-9. Normally I hate Chemtech Soul. I think it's probably the worst soul for 9 out of 10 teams. But you have shield and healing bot lane, you have shield and healing top lane and jungle. You use a lot of it, especially with the Seraph's mid lane, you even get some there. And Mordekaiser just presses W, and getting stacks from that Chemtech is, I now live for 10 seconds longer. My team gets, there's so much scaling than stacking and power, and just a sheer demanding and or dominating lead from TPO. This game went one-sided, and I think what I want to see into next game is really what happens in draft. Can PPP draft themselves an easier comp that's not going to be, we need to meet all of these criteria for a comp to win? Can they adjust how their game plan is? Can they not chase? Can they not make these questionable moments of bad deaths or misplayed deaths of they don't need to happen? These over chases and the biggest thing right back to it is I want to see a better comp. I want to see something beefier. I want to see real frontline. They have the Kassadin and the Hecarim. The Mordekaiser, the Hecarim on the other side of TPO. And then you have Gnar, who even mini Gnar is really no frontline at all. So that, I think, was a big difference because a lot of them were just getting instantly deleted, especially once Kassadin came along, just, you know, even worse. So I definitely want to see what's going to happen and change in these drafts.
Yeah. But with that, we are going to go on a short break as we do get ready for draft for game number two. So we don't go anywhere, and we will be right back.
You say that everything is made up, and I wish that I believed you, 'cause nothing's permanent.
Feel the walls closing under your soul's and radio silence. Keep on low, locked up, riding a cell phone, waiting for closure. Break the spell and break the silence. Are we walking in?
Welcome back, everybody. We are about to get into draft for game two. Definitely an interesting game one. Kind of felt like TPO Cheezer had an idea of what they wanted to do with the draft. They took away the Hecarim. They picked super safe side laners in a Mordekaiser and a Kassadin, where the Mord either ults and goes into a 1v1 if he's getting collapsed on, or the Kassadin just presses R repeatedly until his team goes, catches up to him as he gets chased down by the enemy team. But we are seeing that Poro Party Planners did select blue side for game number two, potentially looking for that Hecarim to be first pick for themselves, as that's going to be something that's contested here, as both of these junglers do play it.
Yeah, okay. They're definitely looking, I think, to respect TPO a little bit more. The Kassadin ban, they don't want to deal with it. Very solid. The Taric ban, okay, so they're not looking to deal with the Taric R either. I'm going to be honest, it is a very nightmarish R. And it's not the easiest thing in the world to counter.
It doesn't also help that his heal has low mana and low cooldown on it. So he can heal people up quick and cost-efficient in replace of the Seraphine from last game that did have a much harder time keeping everybody healthy.
Yeah, exactly. Especially when Seraphine has to get the Echo W just to heal. I personally like Sona better than I do Seraphine. If you're putting somebody there for enchanter purposes, please just use Sona. Seraphine's a mage. Sona is an enchanter. There is definitely a difference between the two of them. And
Sona, I think, scales what people as well.
Yeah, Sona scales immensely better. You put a tier on her, you put Echoes of Helia or Moonstone, whichever is better for the game. I personally like Echoes a lot better in 90% of my games. But that's like a champion that scales well, that always heals. Like late game, her healing is bonkers. Her E and her, like, Chemtech, her with Chemtech is absolutely through the roof. You're building shield items, you're healing, and then Chemtech comes along and, like, adds shielding and healing. That's fucking bonkers. All right. A Swain as a first pick. I don't know if I like that. Especially with no brand. Band. Okay. I do not like this Wayne pick. That is a Nico. I don't like it at all. The Recon pickup for TPO. Okay. Looks like we've picked mid and support. I don't know what is up with people picking mid first. It is absolutely wild to me. This is interesting. This could still be, honestly, this could be a flex. Swain could be support or mid. Morgana could be support or mid. This is interesting. I feel like Morgana's probably support into this Recon, but we'll see. The Master Yi. I hate this pick. The Briar. I hate this pick even more. Oh my lord. Into a Swain. There's a Swain. Why would you do this to yourself? Okay, the Renekton ban. Understandable if it comes through. Right. Sorry, so. <I'm back. laughs> Oh, good. So this is a very interesting development. Sorry, go ahead.
I just got back. I had to get food, the food Ooh. From the door for my son.
Ooh. Listen, food is important. You have priorities, right? go ahead and look at this draft. This is wild. I need to know your opinions on this because I don't like Swain first pick. I think the Nico is really good into it. But the Morgana into Recon, I really like. I hate the Yi pick in a team fighting comp, or any team comp. I think it's better in solo queue. And the Briar into a comp that has Swain Morgana, I don't see this being a good thing. Or even Yi. Yi queues and she starts hitting like minions. Or she gets latched onto taunting herself to Swain, and she infinitely just attacks Swain and dies because of it. Yeah. I like the bans. The Mordekaiser Respect ban, the Renekton Garen, both huge top laners to have to deal with, especially as blindable. If you really just want to be something that can like have some early lane pressure, or Garen with that split putting pressure, and just speed, Mr. Speed, spin to win. But how are you feeling about these three picks on each side so far? Oh, not the rain. Oh God, no. Please.
That's not a crazy amount of range. So far for TPO, I think it's very interesting picks. Yi tends to want to be the center focus for everything. There is a lot to kind of negate him with the Nico ult, the Rakan ult as well can kind of lock him down. So it's one of those things that we do see that there is a bit of lockdown for him. We see the Vayne come out, which is all right. I wonder if it's going to be a Swain APC or if that's a Swain mid lane.
I want to say that that's probably Swain APC, or sorry, mid lane with Morgana support, and that we're about to see the ADC. If it could be APC though. I hate Vayne top lane. I don't like her top lane, or sorry, bot lane. I don't like her top lane, but she's kind of really, that's she's ridiculously APC. Weak. Oh my god. I was wrong. Okay, this is getting interesting.
It's getting spicy. That's a Yee and a Katarina, both that champs love to get online and then just run through teams.
Yeah.
A fed Katarina can do terrible things to you.
Oh, and the set. So this is actually a really, really just outright damage comp coming from TPO. They want to throw the Nico R with CC, the Rakan CC, and then have the Briar Vayne set on top of that. If Set gets to R Ornn into Kat and Yee before they're allowed to do anything, it is going to be a very bad experience for them. They're going to just like get demolished, and if he manages to RE as his combo, it is over for them. He will one punch them mid to late game, and that's going to be a serious problem for them. As well as, you can't really burst a Set down. Yee and Katarina are going to have to look in his face at one point in time in this game. They're going to get E'd. They're going to get have a very rough time. And if he manages to land those W's, they're going to be one shot 30 minutes into this game. So I don't. This is another reason why I don't like assassins like Yee or Katarina in competitive real comp play. I think that they're too easily shut down by coordination for you to be able to get ahead on them or perform on them the way that you would in solo queue, where there's no coordination between an enemy team, so you just get to blink between them and do whatever you want because they're bad at CCing and there's no coordination. So I do like TPO's comp better right now, but that Swain and the Ornn, if they manage to, and with Morgana, if they manage to get Yee and Katarina into the late game, the biggest thing for them is, can they outpush Set? Can they match him in a team fight? Or are they going to try and outscale and shut down the carries and then move forward? The problem then becomes there's Nico, Briar, and Vayne, who are all immense damage dealing and can all be carries. And it's Vayne who scales and destroys everybody, and Set who scales and ends up destroying everybody. So who do you think scales harder in this game? Because I'm kind of leaning towards TPO with their Set Vayne pick, but I think it could be with Ornn.
So I think it depends on what build this Set goes. If you go something like Heartsteel, that could be heavy scaling, just because that continues to stack and stack and stack and stack. If he's going Stridebreaker, it's going to limit his scaling on what he can provide regarding damage. Ornn does automatically give that extra 1,000 gold whenever he upgrades an item. Yee scales hard. Katarina, there's always the joke, Katarina just wants to get a couple kills and then she starts running away with it, where the Katarina can be 0-12 for the start of the game and then all of a sudden gets five kills and then just continues to get pentakills after that because she just got enough. Swain is another one of those heavy scalers as well. While the Vayne will be able to do the true damage with her autos only come out so fast. Well, the Swain's going to be able to infinitely scale with that W. And the pull on the health. So it's going to come down to, honestly, if TPO is looking to split push with this Set or if they're looking to team fight. Because I think the team fight might be dangerous for Poro party planners. They have a ton of AoE and it can get chaotic really quick. With that Briar not always having control of herself, everybody coming in, and if the Katarina or the Yee get on the right targets at the right time, they can potentially just blow up the backline quick, resulting in just the bruiser types in that Briar and that Set to be alive afterwards.
Yeah, absolutely. I personally think that the way TPO wants to play this, or should play this, is they want a 4-1. Let that Set dominate the side lane, because Yee, Katarina, like, he realistically can fight anyone on the team of of PPP, maybe except for Swain, and come out on top winning. If he gets that like solid side lane pressure, if he gets Hallbreaker, Titanic, I'd love to see him with Grasp, get a lot of procs off on that early with the Ornn fighting back and forth, get Heartsteal, immensely scale, and then just go mathematically correct set with Titanic, Steryx, Spear of Shojin, and whatever he decides to finish it off with. Obviously, that's entirely up to him as to how he wants to play that, but that's how I would like to see this. I think that's the better way to play it in terms of scaling, as you said earlier, with the runes in the build is going to be very dependent for him. I want to see if Vayne can pop off. Like I said earlier, she's really not solid in the bot lane. She's in a very rough spot. She's short-ranged, and she takes forever to come online. So... excuse me, I'm not really sure if I like that pick, but I think I do like TPO's comp more.
I think the bot lane, once again, is going to be one of those lanes that they have to outplay on, because they don't have the range difference. They need to scale a bit more before they muted? Can do damage. No, I don't think I'm muted. Why?
Oh, somebody, I think Loki said you might be muted.
That was a while ago when I had stepped away quick. Okay. I think she missed me saying I'll be right back. All right.
Okay. Okay, I just want to make sure. Yeah.
Right. Really? But with that, we are going to go on a short spectator delay as we do get ready for game number two. So don't go anywhere, and we'll be right back.
In my head, it's hard not to forget all the good times we had that have now gone to waste, left alone and misplaced. How can I go on without you? I'm scared to lose myself. How can I move on without you when I have lost my strength? So I'll keep holding on, holding on. Cause things will get better with time. Keep holding on, holding on. I'm not at the end of the line, no.
Times in places where you don't see the life. feels like a dream. I bet won't happen to me. To me. We met somewhere on forbidden lines. Knew I wasn't pure enough for your parents' minds. You still believed I was the one that you need. You need. Now I don't wanna live that you live that you. But old habits hold me down right by the knees. With you I never think about them, think about them. You gave me clarity, I feel so free.
And welcome back, everybody, to game number two of TPO Cheezer versus PPP, the Poro Party Planners that get the best Poro parties. I'm sure Brom is at every one of them. This could be a spicy start. We might be seeing an invade on the side of PPP. I actually do like their comp to do it, but I don't think they did it the best of ways.
There's no vision down. They placed zero vision down. And Vayne is breakdancing. This could be detrimental. There is so much CC. Huge.
They're going to catch her. They're going to catch the Vayne. She can't flash. And it's for, oh my god. First blood to Katarina. This is absolutely huge. PPP just said no. Oh my god.
Yeah, and that's one of those things that you have to like kind of watch out for. What they did is, in that invade, they did the smart play. Both Morgana and Swain threw out their CC in the E and the Q. One put it directly on the Vayne, and the other one did it into that walk pathway that she would have went back into her jungle for. So if the Swains didn't hit and she tried escaping into that jungle, she would still get CC'd. The Ornn took the charge to knock up. We're even seeing the Ornn stepping forward to delay the Briar a bit on that startup. So they had an idea on what they wanted to do here. Look for that early kind of lazy just setup by TPO Cheezer here, and then look for everything else, because Ornn is going to want to scale no matter what. So if he gets up late to top lane, it is what it is. But they got that first kill onto that Katarina, which is going to help out a lot. A double pull from the Swain here in that bot lane. It's looking like a much different game right now for Poro Party Planners, as they are getting more comfortable. And the CC is just landing onto this bot lane.
Oh, this is amazing. This is absolutely incredible to watch. You're right. This is a completely different game. We are definitely not seeing the same play out of PPP. They're more coordinated, it seems. They're more on point, and they're ready to give TPO Cheezer the best five games of their life. We do see a deep ward coming out from set here, so they are trying to figure out where this Z is. They do know that he's not on blue buff, so he does have the advantage of being able to keep a lookout for him if he does to come top lane. Fighting topside a little bit here, though. I think Ornn is... I think Set's coming out on top in these fights, just simply because of the fact that he gets to regen a lot better. And his Q has max health. Oh, the flash coming out from Flagrado just to survive. They're very low here. Bot lane has... This Swain Morgana bot lane has absolutely dominated these two so far.
I want to say this bot lane is more annoying than Lux Morgana. Because when you think
I almost hate you for saying that combo.
but when you think about it, you're like Lux Morgana. One lands Q, the other one follows up Q. Morgana lands Q here. The Swain just throws an E at them, and it doesn't matter if there's minions in front of them or anything, because it goes through the minions and still hits them, and then he pulls them forward.
Yeah, this so is...
forces them not to escape. But we did see top lane. The Set did use his pressure in that top lane to kind of help this Briar out here. bullied the Yi off of his own blue buff and was able to help Ryer 3 buff this Yi here and kind of set him back. It looks like they're going to meet up, though, on the scuttle. Smite goes down, and Yi did get it, and it is level 4. Briar's going to have to back off here. Does have the safety net of the Nico, but the bot lane was definitely going to be more healthy coming over.
Yeah, this is a very rough spot for TPO here. Their bot lane is just getting absolutely run down, I want to say, and it's going to be very rough. Obviously, Vayne is farming a little bit better, but she's also the one who gave first blood. And it's just going to be rough for her. The CC that's coming through, the precision which they're landing it, the amount of coordination between the two of them to land their CC is huge. And the damage that they have, you know, Morgana's passive, where, like, I think it's like 20 or 30% of whatever she does, she heals for, or some nonsensical number. That's huge. Oh, nobody that really thinks about that. Oh my god, side. A pull? And it jumps topside. I hate League auto direction camera.
I think the Rakan W'd in, landed a Q, and then bounced back to Vayne because she was really low when that camera brushed away.
Yeah.
Can you check something for me? How many stacks does Swain currently have?
Swain currently has 12 stacks.
I want to say what they're doing is they're sacrificing the farm a bit for those stacks because they're getting heavy poke in. But we see the Briar come bot side.
This just is
massive amount of poke.
Oh my god, the CC is just huge. The CC and poke, absolutely just huge coming from PPP's bot lane.
Because Vayne wasn't able to join there. The flash was blown by the Rakan to try to engage, but the W missed, so he wasn't able to get anything out of there. They're going to push this wave to get a better back for the Vayne and Rakan, but the Morgana could potentially get a kill here. Flashes forward, but the good knock-up and peel by the Rakan and the Briar.
Yeah, as a support, you can't be that person who thinks that you're that guy. You're not that guy, pal. You're the support. Sit down. Stop trying to do something. Like, you've got to be really careful. And even if they are low health, there's still a Rakan who's really mobile. Like, as one person, you might miss that CC. It's not the same coordination. Vayne has a Q to dodge. Rakan has a W to dodge. So as one person is just Morgana, it's very dangerous to kind of go in like that. Especially when their jungle was just in lane. Like, you never know if she's hovering just out of sight. I think that was a bit of an overstep for them. Like they did last game, where there was a few overstays and oversteps on their part. I think that would
trade a ult here in mid lane as Redisol goes in onto Beaver, and it's going to get a solo kill.
Oh my god.
With the ignite, flashes out a turret there. That is a big play. Now 2-0. This Katarina's already sitting at a 150 gold bounty.
This Katarina is currently 600 gold ahead. That is huge in terms of items, in terms of power early. The top lane, the set is definitely getting more farm. He's getting the gold that he wants. So we do see that Set made a mistake. Set has limited himself to how much he can grow and scale in terms of he has Conqueror, he's building Stridebreaker. And it's not the end of the world. These items are all, you know, it's a good item in a lot of circumstances. Good rune in a lot of circumstances if you want to be fighting a lot. But Orange not necessarily somebody that you can just sit there and, like, you want to fight with, you know? He's a tank. You're going to go back and forth with him because that's what he wants to do, is just wear the bruiser down, you know, do his thing. Oh, my God. That is a huge invade from Aztec Warpriest, and he did it on my main champion, my one-trick champion, Set, the one-punch man. I'm going to clip that. I'm going to clip that. That is a moment for me.
Yeah, that was a big invade, but we're seeing the set and Briar trying to work hand in hand to kind of make sure that the Yee doesn't get online, as they are afraid of what that could possibly mean here if all of these scaling champs do get online. For PPP, it could potentially just mean the end of the game. We even saw Nico ulted the Katarina, and it just wasn't enough. She was forced to flash and use her W to try getting away, and still went down there in that mid lane. We're kind of seeing Poro Party Planners kind of just slow push this wave down bot lane. Here, we do see Yee starting up this Drake. I don't think he was seen by anything going into that dragon pit, so they aren't aware. While Set's just kind of leaving lane again to look for him in that top lane.
Yeah, this Set is actually, I love how proactive he's being. He's saying, hey, I'm big bruiser boy. I'm going to shove my wave. I'm getting a farm lead. It's okay if you get one wave. What is it going to do? And he's walking around. It's already gotten him the advantage of, he has taken down the Yee. He's got that kill on him. He's now taken topside Rift, or sorry, Scuttle, and he's taking blue. This is huge. Cooldowns on Set are getting
caught out here in that mid lane. Good combo of the CC for her. By...
really good, yeah. A little unfortunate for Katarina, but great for them that the shutdown going to Briar, especially, while I think it's very important for Nico to get that, is like huge for Briar.
Briar continues trying to go for these ults from behind the enemy team. She's gonna just choose to walk in now, is walking over Vision. But she hasn't landed the ult yet. I do think
they're not even positioning scared.
No. I do think the one way for this Poro Party Planners to kind of answer what this Set and Briar are doing is to take that top lane turret. I think that's where Herald needs to be dropped. Set has let several plates go over to this Ornn alone, just based off of the fact that Set has continued to invade. I think if they take away that turret, Set's not going to be able to invade safe, because the Ornn can just push the wave out and have it pushing towards that tier 2 and then rotate over and look for Set in that jungle. And yeah, if the Yee's nearby, that's a 1v2 and forces out that Briar ult to try to come protect him there.
So I do think Set is making a big mistake here. This is another reason that I think Set took the wrong runes. This is very pot. This is
good flash forward by
absolutely huge.
Briar was late.
Yeah,
just gonna be farming and kind of trying to pressure this Ornn, who's already got the bramble vest, and is gonna be able to make sure that she's not healing too much.
Yeah. So this is actually going back to what I said in regards to the runes.
Ornn is beating up this Briar.
Oh my god. I do not understand. She's two levels down. She should not be here.
Don't stand there.
Oh my god.
Oh my.
Ornn just got a dump. Okay. So this is a problem.
Ornn OP.
I think Ornn is exceptionally strong. Briar goofed. She's two levels down. There's a bunch of anti-heal and negating auto-attacks, which is what she does. So she's not healing, she's not doing as much damage, and I think Set is encountering the problem of, I'm building damage, I don't have pen, I don't have extra damage to do something. I can't waste money on Black Cleaver right now because I need to get other items online to allow myself to do what I want. And he doesn't have Grasp of the Undying, so he's not getting health procs. He's not building Heart Steel, so he's not just regenning all of this damage and instead of focusing on, like,
hook,
trying to get ahead. That is huge hook. That is a huge hook. Flagrotto might not be
good
able to flash Q. Okay, absolutely huge. Back to a fight topside. Set just needs to stop fighting. He's already down. He no longer has the ability to really just sit there and go in a brawl with him anymore. He gave that up when he chose his runes in his build. Sure, Conqueror is nice, But just hitting somebody with anti-heal and armor and auto-attack negation, what are you going to do when that is your entire champion kit? So it's very rough for this set. He didn't build Bork first, which is a huge problem for him. He's not going grasp to the extra health and focus on what that lane matchup really is. And he is the only front line for his team, realistically. He should have gone Heartsteel, I think, in this game with Grasp. He should have been the tank. He should have taken one for the team and just accepted that he was the front boy. And that's okay, because listen, you still do 3k true damage.
Heartsteel Titanic is massive. My God. But we do see the Morgana getting caught out here. She's going to Black Shield. The Shell Shield
going down.
And try to go in on the Rakan.
The Swain R? Oh, they do pick up the kill, though, with the Ignite.
Flash forward Swain. From the Swain. That's a return kill onto the Rakan. Now
he's running her down. Oh, my God. Absolutely huge.
This bot lane duo of Swain Morgana is massive. Morgana was caught out and still was able to survive long enough with that Black Shield. And on top of that, yeah, they're heavy on AP again, which tends to be what I've noticed is Poro Party Planner's go-to is they love the APs.
Honestly, though, like, I'm okay with it because I think what they're planning is build MR and then he just gets to go wild because nobody has armor.
And Ornn is just bullying everybody, and with the Liandry's that's going to be on both the Morgana and that Swain, that's going to be a jack show onto that Ornn, which is just going to essentially be a second Swain ult. They're trying to go in onto this Swain, but he's going to be able to walk out enough. He's got a 2-level lead over the Swain right now.
Oh, the set the had to ult, but he's right next to the rock. This set is dead. Oh my God. We have a very big problem. Aztec Warpriest definitely wants to be the fighter set, but this is not the game for this. You're trying to fight set into an anti-fighter, into a tank who's meant to be anti-fighter and scale exceptionally well. You're not going to catch... If you can't match his scaling in some way, shape, or form, it doesn't matter. Yeah, you might be able to like hit W, but if you're not like doing anything with it, what does it matter? If you can't match him, what does it matter? He's now taken 2 kills on set. He's got his tower. He's been able to outpush into his tower the entire game because of what he's doing, and the fight just is not fair. Set has no extra survivability on top of like his regen, and while his regen is huge, it's simply not enough. And we're now seeing the leads coming out, and this is a very blue side favored series, it seems, where Ornn is ahead 3-0, which is actually terrifying. You don't ever, you know, Ornn's a character that you always see going even, never coming out ahead, and when you see them ever do come There's out ahead, it's oh my God.
Oh, that damage from the Katarina just instantly chunking her out. But that's a double pull by this Swain. Vayne and Rakan are going to have to run away as he was coming in.
Oh, the Briar onto Briar. This Katarina. She does manage to get the kill. Yeah, I don't think hopping that way was the right way to go. It doesn't seem like we've got a Rift Herald bot lane, and instead we're watching the... Oh, Briar knocks Li into tower and takes him out with 2 tower shots. Outplayed amazingly. Oh my God, this Briar is actually...
Ooh, a teleport in from the set. This is going to be a 3v2 for right now. A second Imagine teleport TP from Ornn. As well as Nico's coming Ornn in.
Ornn gets there first. This could be a problem.
It's currently a 1-for-1. The top lane for support... Now the support might go down here in the Rakan, but he's going to be able to get out. The knockup does not land from the Ornn. Swain's they're trying to run out as Briar and Nico are on top of him.
But they can't get him. This is going to be a demolish, and that's second tier tower for bot lane.
That's a forced flash out by the Ornn as well. Ornn's still in trouble, though.
He doesn't have much MR. I don't know why everyone loves... This should not be happening. I don't care if it is a 4v1. 3 of them re-engaged on somebody with Sunfire with very low health. That could have gone a lot worse. Yeah, They got very lucky. Oh my god, wait. The Katarina might clean up here. Oh my god. Jumps onto the Briar. Ooh. Catches her out. Great play by the Katarina.
Yeah. Well, we did see, I want to say it was a 2-for-1 in that bot lane, but that was 3 turrets over to PPP for just 2 kills. 3 turrets and a kill for two kills.
Yeah. Yeah, this is
rough to see.
This is wild. We're definitely seeing, I want to say, 3.5-4K gold lead here. Again, Swain is up 1,000 gold. Morgana's up 400 gold, which it might not be a lot, but in terms of support, that's huge. The mid lane gold diff is 2,000 almost in favor of Katarina. The jungle diff is 1,000 in favor of Briar. So this is still like a very interesting jungle matchup. I think that Briar is doing better, but on the team basis, Ornn is 2,000 gold ahead of Set. This is a problem. You know, as Set, that if you're 2,000 gold behind Ornn, you are having a serious problem and a crisis, and you need to fix something because something is not going the way you want to. And this Ornn is getting abusive. It's going to take. What amazes me is that this Ornn is out split pushing a Set. He needs 3 people to respond to him, and then Yi just comes in. So we see the Yi. Oh, Yi with the Briar ult onto the Yi. The Ornn ult to read. Oh, but the re-engage of Katarina. Oh my god. What is going on? That was huge. 3-for-1 in favor of PPP. They give the Yi, but what does it matter? Ornn's going to have to back off of this, though. I'm not sure Baron's the right call with Yi being dead, as they don't have a whole bunch of damage for it. So they're going to have to back off here. It is unfortunate that the one person to die happened to be the Yi, the only one who's really good at doing that damage to objectives in a large amount. But it's okay. You killed 3 people. Ornn's still big. Katarina's massive. Swain is 5-0. He's huge. There's no real problem here for PPP. TPO, on the other hand, that'd be a serious problem. First off, their jungle and their top lane are building exactly the same. This is, you have 2 people building the exact same thing and both coming out with the same result, except Briar has finished boots and Set doesn't. Briar has 5 kills, Set has 1. We're now seeing as well, ornaments are coming out, already Swain getting his. This game is over in my opinion. I mean, you're not going to match the scaling because you've chosen to take the fighting runes instead of scaling runes and build. Briar, I just think is, you know, you're running into Ornn, Swain. What are you going to do about it? And like we had discussed earlier, in Vayne, like I said, she takes forever to come online as an ADC. She's just not a great ADC pick, and she has so many problems. Like, Rakan is an amazing support, but Vayne, I think, is the main problem in the bot lane. There's not a lot you can do with Vayne. She's not the ADC right now. So this is a very difficult place for TPO Cheezer to be right now.
Sorry, I'm just trying to deal with something because I just got notification that the stream is lagging a bit behind us right now. But we do see PPP just going for this Baron. Briar is on the other side. She is trying to go in. The smite goes down for PPP. No. It is going to be a sacrifice of the Briar for the attempt. But it is something that they are able to get. And this might just end up being the kind of the nail on the coffin for Cheezer, as the Ornn items are starting to come through now. And the team fight comp that they have made is just massive. The Ornn is flashing ahead. Not one. The Swain is flashing ahead.
We did have someone just leave game though. Oh, and they reconnected. Okay. Yeah, that fight was immensely. That was a very quick pause and unpause. I didn't even see what just happened. Anyways, the game says that there was, which is
how weird.
Unpaused has paused the game. Yeah, but an unpause. I didn't even notice it.
Forward from the Nico here gets a massive knockout to three. A big one as the Vayne is now trying to counter and go for a bit more. It does get the shutdown. It is actually, I didn't even catch it. It's an Iceborne Gauntlet Orn.
That's a huge.
Vayne die, though. Two minions. That was.
I'm not a fan of the Iceborne here. Vayne dying. Oh, man, these teams are making these small overstays or oversteps that are getting them killed. And it's kind of very interesting to watch that they keep doing it. And, like, I know there's certain reasons to sometimes try and push it, but I feel like they're just overdoing it, both teams.
I think this Vayne build is a bit interesting. It's not one that I've seen before. I know Vayne right now is one of those champs that you don't really know what to build on her. And there's so many different builds. I've seen, like, tankier Vaynes. I've seen Heartsteel. I've seen,
I think... realistically, if you're taking Vayne, you need to have lethal tempo because scaling. And no matter what, Rage Blade is the item. You want to have, like... Oh, okay, we're seeing the catch on a Briar, and Briar just goes down. This is to me, why I don't like Briar. If she's in a situation like this, what is she going to do? She can't get out. She Ws, and she's taunting herself to them. Like, she just kills herself. Okay, we're seeing two upgraded Leandri's Lament, as well as Ornn's own upgraded item here. So the ornaments are coming out. They're rolling out pretty fast here. I don't know. I think, like Vayne is very similar to me, like, to Kalista. You want to have something like Bork into Kraken, maybe, or Runons, or maybe even both if you're in a good situation, into Rage Blade. And maybe something else that just, like, Lord Dominic. Oh my god, Nico. The Pop Blossom.
Good key.
He is going down. Oh my god. You know what? I know that they picked the Yi here for a reason, but I feel like Yi has been so underwhelming this entire game. She's got Bork, she's got Berserkers, she just finished Rage Blade, but I feel like she's been very underwhelming this whole game. I don't know.
Careful here.
Zed is very lucky. He's got a little bit of vision, but his team sees a lot of the other team on the other side of the map.
Horn, I think Zed still gets out, but this is going to be the second Drake for TPO Cheezer. The Swain's trying to look for something. A good two-man pull. And the Katarina is on the back line. That is a triple kill over for them. It is just the Briar and the set to defend. Ornn is teleporting.
Ornn is TPing. This is funny because last game we saw the Mordekaiser TP in. So it's almost like, hey, you did this to us. We're going to do it right back. This is going to be five games. I am absolutely loving these two matches. Two completely different team comps for each side. This game is, and it's still not over. That's the best part about this, is they are fighting. TPO Cheezer does not want this game to be over. But I just don't think that they stand a chance. This game is over.
Yeah, this is...
They fought, but I think it's over. Yeah. I think that was a... There was a well-fought loss. I don't think it was as big of a gap as I want to say as the first game. But bot side was so dominant. Top side was so dominant. Mid was dominant. But then we don't see the Yi around very much. Okay, we see some assists. We see some objectives. But, like... the damage was not there. I think if you're going to pick a carry assassin mid lane, then jungle needs to be a facilitator for that. You can't pick another carry assassin because then that jungle is not being facilitated in any way, shape, or form. And I think it was a little bit of a weak point that TPO definitely took advantage of, especially Set invading, Briar invading. But it just wasn't enough for them to overcome the Katarina, the Ornn, the Swain, and even the Morgana. It just sheer damage that was there sustained. Morgana's got 10k more damage than Rakan. But that 10k damage is huge. Vayne's got 7k less than Swain. Again, huge in that early game difference. Mid game is actually about equal in damage. I think Nico was really close to doing it. But I don't know how you feel about this, but I want to see this draft and these runes and these build choices just change for TPO. If you're going to do a comp like this, I think Briar needs to go slot in a facilitator in. You have Set, you have Nico, slot in that facilitator. Same issue for PPP, slot in that facilitator jungle.
Not to interrupt, but there is a few things that I need to do in between game two and three. I do have, please don't go anywhere. I'm having some PC issues, so I'm going to try to restart. My Wi-Fi, internet looks fine, but my computer itself is kind of running slow where we're getting a couple minutes behind. So do not go anywhere. We shall be right back for game number three.
Don't let go my hand. No need to pretend. I want you forever. I will love you to the end. Hoping that you will stay right here by my side. Cause right now I need to find my way back to you. Hoping that I can see you when I open my eyes. Cause right now I need to find my way back to you. Should I go left? Should I go right?